Hello, anyone and everyone. I am Echo, and today we are exploring Obduction. We are here over in front of the house. I came over to the other side to check out some more little spots, just nook and crannies, really, that we haven't yet seen. For one, I do believe we forgot to check inside this mine shaft, which, of course, just leads to an immediate dead end, with another little view of the alien landscape over here. But this does remind me of one thing that a tiny criticism. It's an entirely subjective point, and it's not even that big of a deal, even in my opinion. But one little thing about Obduction compared to the Myst series is that, and this is an opinion I've held ever since I first heard of Obduction, long before release, long before I played it, long before I started playing it, I should say, to be more accurate. Ever since I first heard about its setting, I have to say I was a little slightly disappointed, because the Myst series was an entirely original setting, an entirely original world, an entirely original story. There's nothing quite like it. Although it uses physical objects that look familiar or might straight come from the real world. Like, in the Stone Ship Age, it's a big rock poking out of the ocean, and there's a boat attached to the rock. You know? Those are things that exist in real life. But nonetheless, the setting of the Myst series was entirely original. It was set in, like, a big thing of parallel universes, with this, like, borderline magic, yet ultimately scientific method of traveling between these alternate dimensions through writing the linking books, which, again, is, like, an entirely original idea. I've never heard of another story or world where people travel around through teleportation created by, you know, writing a book to describe the place where you want to go, and stuff like that, you know? So, it was an entirely original story, and original world, and original setting, and everything like that, whereas Obduction seems to very much take place where our character and all the other people that we're interacting with came from the real world. They came from Earth, from the world that you and I live in real life. They came from there, and every single house and piece of technology that you see around, in at least this biodome, also came from Earth. And so, in a way, it's sort of adhering to reality and adhering to real life. And although there's clearly a lot of science fiction, impossible technology and stuff like that going on, because it is set in an, you know, alien sci-fi story where aliens have abducted people, and so there is some of that stuff going on. Ultimately, a story of people being abducted by aliens and even traveling to other planets has been done before. So Obduction leaves the realm of the entirely original setting that Myst was and goes into basically its own twist on a sci-fi story about being abducted and going to another planet, you know, which other people have done. You know, there's thousands of sci-fi stories about going to alien planets. There's hundreds, if not thousands, of stories about people being abducted, and I'm sure there's plenty about people being abducted and then going to an alien planet. You know, obviously I haven't read every book in existence, so I can't say them all. But the point is, it's just a slightly more less original, slightly less original setting in this case, because they're taking a trope that has been done before and doing it in their own way. And so far, like I've said, with the architecture and the world design, they are definitely doing it in a very visually distinct Myst type of way. But ultimately, the setting is, you know, it's just not as original, which isn't a big deal. I'm still enjoying it, but whatever. I had to say that. to just get it off my chest, basically. But anyway, here's some more graves that we didn't see before. This one says Daniel Hartnell. Carl Hunrath. Okay, so that's interesting. That's the, I believe that's the first person we've seen whose last name was Hunrath. And that makes me wonder, was he the one who founded the town? Since the town's obviously named Hunrath. John Farley and Robert Hartnell. Okay, two people buried in one place. That's a little odd. Maybe. Luther Roscoe. Ida Liance? John Hartnell, something something, 1881, beloved husband, father, caretaker, grandfather. Oh, beloved husband, father, grandfather, and then I cannot read the bottom line. Mary Hartnell, 1815 to 1887, I'm gonna guess. I can't read the first date of his name there. Mamu Mary, loved by all. Oh, so she was nicknamed Mamu Mary because she probably acted a little bit like a mother figure for everybody in the town, was very friendly and got along well with everyone. But now she's dead, so where did that get her? Huh. There's another one of those red rocks that, again, sticks out from the environment, but this time it's obscured by a blue rock, so that one's probably not important. Maybe. Who knows? Not me. Alright. So yeah, we covered this little side over here. Whoopsie. That was one place I wanted to check that we sort of skipped over because I was trying to look all around and get an idea of what all the various areas we could go to are. And in the process, of course, I sort of glanced over things and didn't look at them in very good detail. We did see back here, that's just where another track for the minecart goes. And we did check up here, where we've got the weird shimmering rocks and these... other things. I don't even know what to call these. But they're something. They're something weird. And we did see a glow bug, sort of. I think it flew from here. I can't even remember now. I can't remember if it flew from here and went to the house, or if we saw one fly from, like, the front of the house over to here. Cannot remember. But I'll have to keep that area in mind, because it looks pretty significant. The fact that the rocks are doing that weird shimmering effect, and then there's those uniquely shaped blue rock things over there, seems like it's probably a significant place. Alright. So now, oh, is this a staircase we can go up? Oh, it is! Okay, so we don't have to go down between the buildings. I didn't notice this before. I thought it was a... thought it was sheer rock face there. But okay, that leads back around to behind the tree. Oh, and here's some more shimmering rocks. I think we actually, I believe in the first episode, I believe we actually saw these from the other side. And there's a definite track that goes right through those. I'm willing to bet at some point we're going to get a way to remove these shimmering rocks. I bet they are, like, if not holograms, they're something else. And we're going to find a way to just sort of phase them out of existence, I bet. It's just my guess, just my theory. I have to constantly think about every possibility in order to try and predict what we have to do. Not that it's important to know in advance what we're going to be doing, but by preparing in advance, it basically makes it easier for me to solve the puzzles. So, the waterfall. It's got another little bit of story from Yosef, I bet.
Part of our ecosystem here is our supply of water. It is supplied as a natural process of the system itself, and we don't really understand how. Although the entire system is very closely tied together. The fact that one of the most important necessities of life has been provided to us has led many to believe that this place has a purpose. Others attribute to a complex natural process, which we one day hope to understand. But either way, we are glad to have all the water we need.
Yeah, that is weird. I didn't think about it until now, but the water seems to be coming from nowhere. If y'all bear with me for a moment, I'm gonna head back on up that elevator real quick to just take a quick look at it, because it does seem like the water sort of comes from the... If I remember correctly, I'm about to check it out again, of course. It does seem like the water sort of... Oh, no, stuttering, please stop. Wait, why won't it move now? Oh no. Oh no. Wait a minute. Did the thing... Oh man, that's right. There was a waterfall coming down here. And the waterfall was turning those paddles. It's like a small water mill, basically. And by turning the paddles, that's what powered the elevator. But we turned that lever up at the top that opened the big gate. And since it basically released the pressure on the water, the water went out the big waterfall out front. That one right out over there. And so the water stopped. Basically the water was being diverted. The water, due to how gravity works, would rather have gone out this side because it's a much bigger opening, and that waterfall mouth is probably a little bit lower than that one over there, but with the gate down, it was blocking the water and making the water divert to there, hitting the paddles, powering the elevator, and allowing us to go up. And I guess it didn't need much power to go down, because it's probably safe to assume that whatever generator was being powered by the small waterfall probably had enough power left in it to let us go down, because of course when we're going down, we're also being helped by gravity, so it wouldn't take much power to begin with. Alright, so I believe, if I'm not mistaken, I do believe we've covered every nook and cranny of this area, except for what is right over here. And there seems to be a little door over there, another lever here, and a big gate. We probably need to get this gate open, don't we? Don't we? Okay. Oops, whoops, whoops. Go back up to the middle position. So, at this point, it's not blocking the water at all. Clearly. In this position, the water is being blocked on the left side partially and being let through completely on the other side. When it's even, it doesn't do anything, really. Okay, so what's the purpose of this? What does it do? Does it affect the thing up top at all? Let me see. I do not notice any change in the walkway up top. Nothing's lowering or shifting or anything, as far as I can tell. So this is probably purely a way of diverting the water. Though, of course, it's not doing a very good job of diverting the water. Only sort of slows it down on one side. But okay. Alright, let's check if that door's locked before I go messing with the lever. I bet it is. Yep. Alright, and there's just a tunnel in there. Tunnel looks like it leads through the rocks around this big wall here. Oh, it could just be a dead end, of course. Alright. Lever time. What'd that do? Okay. That is making that thingy. You know what? This is a good chance to unlock the cursor. That's making that thing lift up. And every time it lifts up, the gate, or the walkway up top, moves slightly. And then that, right there, that little, I don't know what you'd call it, just metal arm, that's actually blocking it, because it seems to be, seems that every time you pull this lever, it tries to turn, with that end going that way, and this end coming towards us. But the metal arm is blocking it, so that's why it's not turning. Alright. Of course, to move the metal arm, it looks like we'd have to pull that lever, but we can't do that because there's no way to get up there, as far as I can tell. Alright, so let's see if there's any difference when we do it like this. I don't really think this would affect it, as far as I can see. Yeah. No, it doesn't seem to be changing anything. Of course, that has not moved the metal arm. Okay. Oh! I see what it did. Okay. So, by putting the left side down, it wasn't blocking the water. It was being pushed by the water. So that when we pull the lever to try to lift that up, which basically, I guess lifting that up is sort of just loosening the whole gate to allow it to be pushed by the water. But when it's being pushed on the left, that means it would turn clockwise, but get hit by the arm. And by putting the right side down, that means it was getting turned counterclockwise. And so it turned and opened up for us. So now I wonder, now that it's in this position, is it even possible to turn it back to where it was? At this point, it seems like... Okay. Yeah, so at this point, it doesn't make a ton of sense that the water would push it this way. Because if it's... And I guess, actually, let me just demonstrate real quickly. If it's in the middle here, since the water is very lightly touching each side, I guess it makes sense that it wouldn't move at all when it's in this position either, because it would be basically, it'd be getting pushed by the water evenly on both sides. But, when it's in this position, honestly, I don't think it makes a ton of sense to have the, water make the gate close at that point, because in this position, with the water going vertically against the gate, it probably wouldn't have enough push on it, even with this side down, to make it turn. But oh well. Okay, so we've gone through there. Is that... that right there that the cursor's pointing at, that looks like a person. Probably not, but, you know. I can freak out and get spooked a little bit if I want to. Alright. So it looks like, to me, the next goal, generally speaking, should be to get up there and release that metal arm so that the gate can move freely. Alright, what's all this now? Got two paths. That one leads deeper into the forest. This just leads to a little hangout spot. Pretty nice looking place, too. Okay, so it's just a little... somebody hung up their clothes here, presumably to go swimming. And there's more on the other side, too. Somebody set up an easel to make a painting. Of course, we can't get to the other side because the gate wouldn't turn the other way. But, yeah. Really nice place. And like I said, we saw this big forest coming because we could see the trees over the top when we were standing up on top of the place with the lasers coming out of it. It's actually much bigger than I thought. And it seems that the whole biodome thing in general seems to be more of an oval shape rather than a circle. But these stairs up here lead over to this place. Okay, so that's how we have to get up there. We have to find a way to lower that walkway, which would actually end up being a flight of stairs in order to get up there. Unless... there doesn't seem to be... yeah, there doesn't seem to be any mechanism attached to it. It's probably just kind of something that you push down. So maybe that's actually a shortcut. We get up there from the other direction, come over here, and then just push it down so that we can freely walk up and down. Because it doesn't look attached to any kind of mechanism, and it seems like... seems reasonable enough that maybe there's a, you know, it's just sort of like grinding against the inside there. It's not heavy enough to fall down on its own, because the way it was designed presumably would be would make it so it wouldn't just fall loosely. Okay, oh, the stuttering's happening again. This is annoying. There's the wall that's on the other side of the tree, by the looks of it. And, here's a big ol' fucking building. Don't know what this is for, but it looks cool. And, again, kinda reminiscent of the place from Riven. And also, This is actually giving me some freaking PTSD flashbacks here. Gonna go and open this up. Foliage down to medium, sure. Let me guess, that's gonna help the frame rate immensely, isn't it? Shoot. Maybe. We're still getting stuttering, though. Because I remember in the, in the, what was it called? Real Myst Masterpiece Edition, the version that I played through on my channel. In that game, the grass really hit the frame rate hard. And I don't know if these were made on the same engine, but it seems, holy shit, please stop. You know what? Foliage all the way down to low. There you go. I don't know if that's gonna help much, but, yeah, the grass is basically all gone. So that's great. Still getting stuttering. This is very painful. Honestly, man. I hope the game gets patched soon, because I want to be able to play this as smoothly and comfortably as possible without having to stop every minute or so to complain about the stuttering. Let's check out this, though. There's a button on it. Of course, no power. Of course, this thing would take a massive amount of power. Oh, some motorcycles! That's neat. They used a motorcycle to, as the third leg of the thing. That's kind of funny. Can we actually, do anything with this? Seems like something we'd be able to interact with, but I guess not. Alright, and there's another little... Looks like a addition to the mining operation? Not sure. Oh, and there's more buildings and a train and another thing up there. There's a lot of stuff. Alright, let's check out this side first. It seems to be the smaller of the two. Oh, hey! Here is a little map. Alright. Town, CW, Tower, Sphere, Garage, Scrap, Tunnels, Ramp, Farley. Okay, so Farley must be Farley's house. So, let me get this straight in my head here. That... fucking stuttering, please stop. That rock line. That, like, hard, impassable mountain there of the red rocks that seem to go through the middle of the entire area. That seems to be the, darker orange spot in the middle here, with that tower being what, from the other side, looked like a spaceship. Maybe it's a spaceship that they, fitted to become a tower. Now, I don't know for certain that that's the tower the map is referring to, but it's the tallest thing around here, and it most resembles a tower, so I'm gonna say that's probably the tower. So that's the town, the, old Wild West place that that we came through. That'd be Foley's house. So, basically we've gone around in a big sort of circle, which means we already sort of passed the CW area, I guess? Or not really. That's... Because it seems like we were more or less... When we came by the water bridge thing, that seemed to be more or less along the edge of the area. But if my orienteering skills are even remotely correct, it seems like it would have been right about here. And it seems like we sort of came around this way. Like, we started the game over here when we first opened up, moved down here to Farley's house and the couple of surrounding areas. Then we went up here through the town, then across over, and then down here. And then we'd be... The sphere. Sphere's gotta be that big thing. Without a doubt. And then... The red dot. I guess this would be the place we're at right now. The red dot in the middle that connects to everything else would be this spot in front of us. Or actually, more specifically, this very generator would be the red dot right in the middle. Okay. So then, in that case, actually, if we know that... sphere is right there. That power line connects to here. And the tower connects to that one. And they both meet here. Then, sphere and tower go right there. So then the next one over would be CW. So tower, sphere, CW's line. So, out of curiosity, real quick, let's go and follow... Fucking stuttering, please! Let's go and follow CW's line and see where it leads us. Oh, why can't I get through here? Okay, fine. And the game is stuttering more and more as it auto-saves. Could that be a problem? Could the autosave also be causing a bit of stuttering? That would be a huge annoyance. Yeah, that's the same line. That seems to be CW's line. CW is the quote-unquote bad guy that Farley told us about. Since she told us it was dangerous and... It was dangerous because CW might be around. And, oh, the music just kicked up at the perfect opportunity. So that line seems to stop here. This is the house of the guy that we talked to who offered to help us get out of here. This is where that line stops, and assuming I followed that line correctly, that line was labeled CW, and it led back here. So, logically speaking, that guy who offered to help us is probably CW. Which, honestly, I should have seen coming. But yeah. So CW, the guy that Farley warned us about, is the guy who's helping us, and we're also trying to help. Okay, cool. That's cool for me. Hey, I don't know anything about this town. I don't know if Farley is trustworthy, or if CW is trustworthy, or whatever. I mean, at the beginning of the original Myst, you meet the two brothers, Cirrus and Akinar, and both of them, one of them seems sort of comic book supervillain evil. Other one seems a little bit crazy. Each of them says that they're innocent and that the other one is the bad guy. You don't know who to trust. By the end of the game, it turns out neither of them are trustworthy. This could be another situation like that. I don't know anything about Farley, except that she's the narrator of the game, which is unfortunately very immersion-breaking way of solidifying a character as a good guy. It's kind of unlikely that Farley would turn out to be a bad person and betray us, because she is the narrator, and games usually wouldn't do that. They usually wouldn't have a bad guy be the narrator for the story, but nonetheless, still, it is possible, and we don't know anything about her, and we don't know anything about CW. We only have her word that CW is not to be trusted, so... And if that even is CW, who knows? I mean, that could be a different person who moved into CW's house after CW left. It's not necessarily him, but it's most likely him. Oh well, anyway, point is, we will go back over there to the sphere and the power grid and everything else, and we will explore that more next time. I hope you all have enjoyed this. I know I have immensely, and I will see you all later. Bye-bye. Thank you.